Frank Lawrence is dead, choked by his own blood, and he needn't have been. Red Barnes let him die, and he needn't have died. Frank was an only child. Somebody is going to have to tell his folks and tell his girlfriend. And somebody is going to try to comfort him. Will anybody try to comfort Red Barnes, who, heaven help us, let a man die, and who, heaven help him, knows he did? He didn't damn well know what to do. And so Frank Lawrence is dead. Would you have let him die? He needn't have done, you know. It might surprise you to know that in this country every year over 20,000 people die accidentally. Of these, many, perhaps many thousands would have lived if the first person on the scene had known what to do. Thousands of unnecessary deaths. And that's a terrible lot of needless grief, misery, and distress. And it could have been avoided. Surely it's worth learning the few, the very few simple things which make all the difference between life and death. But first, let's meet Joe. This is Joe, a man, a human being like you or me. Well, sort of. Anyway, he breathes. His manly heart beats. And rich red blood flows in his manly veins. Which is just as well, because otherwise he'd be dead. Wait a bit, Joe. You're not dead yet. That comes later. And this is Josie, his girlfriend. She's human, too, and just as likely to die as Joe. No, don't die yet, either of you. When you get down to it, four things will kill Joe or Josie. First, if something stopped her breathing, for example, she'd die in a few minutes. All right, Josie, you can die now. This way of dying is called asphyxia. Or again, if he lost all his blood, he'd die just as sure. Thirdly, shock might kill him. No, hold it, Joe, not that sort of shock. Here we're talking about shock following an accident or associated with illness, perhaps without any obvious injuries. That sort of shock is certainly a killer. For if that girlish heart stopped beating, she wouldn't last long. Those are the four main killers. And this is the point. Suppose when one of these things is happening to Joe, you come on the scene. You have a chance to save Joe's life, a good chance. What would you do? You might do one of three things. Nothing, except watch him die, and live with a bad conscience forever. Or you might help him to die quicker by doing the wrong thing. Do the right thing and save his life. Now, dying is no joke. It's usually a horrible, sordid business. And it's nearly always a desperately upsetting occasion for anyone present or connected with the victim. Don't fool yourselves. No one can stand by and watch a man or woman die without a lasting scar on the memory. But saving life is a different story. And at any moment, today perhaps, your chance could very well come to save a life which, without you, is lost. To catch one of those 20,000 Joes at the critical moment between the accident happening and qualified help arriving. This critical moment came for able seaman Jim Metcalf one bright morning by the sea.
Help!
Jim may not be the world's greatest lifesaver in water, maybe, but he does know about the kiss of life when somebody stops breathing. He knows that he mustn't waste a second in getting air into her lungs. He knows that to do so, he must get the head right back, otherwise the tongue may be closing the throat. He knows he has to close the nostrils, otherwise the air he blows in escapes through them. There's nothing difficult about the kiss of life, and even if you know no more than you've just said about it, have a go. You've nothing to lose, and a life to gain. So man, woman, or child, have a go. Of course, drowning isn't the only occasion when you might discover somebody not breathing. Coal gas accidents are a particular hazard to old people, and coal gas will certainly stop anyone breathing. Or, as the papers put it, an overdose of drugs. That's a familiar enough cause of interrupted breathing. And so are the fumes from a car exhaust. And there are many others. But whatever the cause, if the casualty's not breathing, have a go with a kiss of life. It saves hundreds of lives a year and could save many more. If you find Joe not breathing, the kiss of life at once, or soon. It can't be too soon. And now let's think about bleeding. With bleeding, the critical moment between injury and death isn't difficult to spot. This time, saving a life is easy. If the casualty is bleeding, stop it. Don't mess about with tourniquets or pressure points. You could easily make matters worse. Just get a pad of something, almost anything, and press it hard to the wound and keep it there. Notice the corporal has put the driver on his side first. This is because he's also bleeding from the mouth, which may mean internal injuries. Lying like this, the blood won't choke it, as it did for Frank Lovett. If it's an arm or a leg, and it's easy to do it, lift up the limb to slow down the flow of blood. With bleeding, we often tend to think of road accidents, but bleeding can result from any number of accidents in any number of places, including the home. We're not concerned here with why accidents happen, who was right or who was wrong. All we're interested in is what should be done when the accident happens. As they certainly do. Any do-it-yourself man should know the do-it-yourself first aid for bleeding. A pad, and pressure, and then qualified help. You don't have to be grown up to save a life in this world. So if you come on Joe or Josie pouring blood, get in there with your pad and apply pressure. That's all. And don't waste time. You can faint or be sick later. The next of our four killers to consider is shock. Shock in the doctor's sense, that is.
Ha!
Shock is an accompaniment to almost any accident and is much more dangerous than most people imagine. The first aid treatment is to keep him quiet, to make him comfortable, and to reassure him that he's going to be all right and that everything's under control. Gentleness and compassion count for a great deal. There should be no fuss. Don't let him have anything to drink. It may be a nuisance later if hospital treatment is necessary. Cover him up if it's cold or if it's raining, but avoid heavy blankets and such things. They could be bad for him. But the great thing is a calm, comforting, reassuring manner. Indeed, since in any accident, shock may always be present, the approach of the first aider must always be to comfort and encourage the casualty. Even the reassuring words of a youngster can help. You're never too young to save a life. Shock is everywhere. The man who collapses suddenly in the street is just as likely to suffer shock as any other casualty, and needs the same gentleness and compassion to help him over. So if you find Josie in a state of shock, and this means after almost any accident, be kind to her. Reassure her. Comfort her. Encourage her. And it's usually best not to give her anything to drink. So that's shock, the third of our killers. The fourth is the stoppage of heart, which doesn't necessarily mean that the victim's dead, although he certainly will be if something isn't done very soon. Severe electric shock will probably stop breathing, so the kiss of life is needed. But it may also have stopped his heart. If the victim's condition doesn't improve after a few breaths, and if the first aider is unable to locate a pulse, he can infer that the heart has stopped and must set about restarting it with all possible speed. This method of restarting a stopped heart is not difficult, but it does have to be learned. But for the presence here of a fully trained first aider, this man would certainly be dead. As it is, he'll probably survive. So how about it? What about getting yourself taught to massage a heart back into action? Finally then, if Joe's heart stops, what are you to do? If you've learned how to do heart massage, do it. If you haven't, poor old Joe's a goner, and you're not going to think much of yourself standing there helpless while he does. Well, that's it then. On the one hand, there's a dead man, Frank Lawrence, and Reg Barnes, who didn't know what to do and let him die. On the other hand, there's able seaman Jim Metcalf, who knew how to give the kiss of life. As a matter of fact, Jim Metcalf did more than save a life that day. Then there was Corporal Handley and his girl, who knew about applying pressure to stop bleeding, and who, incidentally, by their prompt actions, earned themselves good friends for life. Friends who might easily have been dead. Then Miss Pearson knew how to cope with a badly shocked man. He may never know it was Miss Pearson who saved his life, but that doesn't worry her particularly. She knows that when the chance came along, she did what had to be done. And that's satisfaction enough for her. Saving a man's life by heart massage was something Petty Officer Newman knew he might be called on to do at any time. As a medical assistant, it's part of his life. But there's not always a P.O. Newman above. Perhaps there's only you there. So why not make sure you're not the one who stands by and lets somebody die? It might be your wife, or your child, or your father lying there dying. or just another human being who needs your help. And you, with a little effort, a very little effort, may be able to let Joe or Josie live, to let them enjoy the good things of life, to continue to be useful citizens instead of forgotten bones in an early grave. So what about it? Don't you let him die.